In 1890, August Kekulé gave a speech at the 25th anniversary celebration of the publication of a paper on the cyclic structure of benzene. In this speech, he told a story of falling asleep in front of a fire while working on a textbook. In his dream, carbon chains were twisting and turning like a snake. The head of one snake grabbed its own tail and started spinning. I honestly can't tell you if this is a real dream that Kekulé had in 1865, a colorful tale he made up in 1890, or an opium-induced haze, as much of the internet would have you believe. But Kekulé's dream is a great way of explaining what is happening with those six delocalized electrons in benzene. This is part three in a series where I take you on an historical journey to piece together the structure of benzene. You might want to watch parts one and two first, but it's not strictly necessary. Benzene is an important molecule in organic chemistry. For a long time, it was used as a universal organic solvent. This is because benzene is very, very good at dissolving other nonpolar compounds, but it's also very stable, meaning it does not react very easily. So we could dissolve other things in benzene, we could let those other things react with each other, and we could just largely ignore what benzene was doing because it wasn't really doing anything. We did eventually have to stop using it for this purpose because we unfortunately found out that it's a carcinogen, but its structure stumped early chemists for a long time. So in 1865, Kekulé proposed this structure. We have six carbons in a ring, alternating single and double bonds. This is very, very close to correct, but it does not paint the whole picture. And in fact, this is in complete disagreement with some of the observations that we had made about benzene at this point in time. So we knew that benzene did not contain any carbon-carbon double bonds, but Kekulé's structure contained three. We also knew that if you were to replace any two of these hydrogens with halogens completely at random, benzene had three possible products, but Kekulé's structure looks like it has four. Kekulé did propose that we just couldn't tell the difference between these two structures. They both have halogens on neighboring carbons, just separated by double bond versus single bond, but a lot of people still weren't convinced. In 1901, we did get confirmation that benzene contained six carbons in a ring, so that was one step closer to saying Kekulé was on the right track, but it wasn't until the 1930s that we got the last piece of the puzzle that we needed to finally figure out what this structure was. So in the 1930s, we were able to measure these carbon-carbon bond lengths, and they were all the same. This is a huge deal because carbon-carbon single bonds are longer than carbon-carbon double bonds. All six of these are the same, and they are not the same length as either single or double bonds, but somewhere in between. So think of them as 1.5 bonds in length. But if all six of these carbon-carbon bonds have the same length, then they also all have to have the same number of electrons. Benzene is following a different set of rules. It has delocalized electrons. Let's talk about what that means. I want you to understand the difference between sigma bonds and pi bonds. Electrons orbit the outermost part of atoms, and each electron has its own region of space or territory where it's most likely to be found. These territories are called orbitals. Orbitals come in different shapes and sizes, but if the orbitals of two different atoms overlap and share electrons, that's called a covalent bond. So imagine that you have an orbital that's dumbbell-shaped. The nucleus is in the very center. This region of space is where electrons are most likely to be found if they're assigned to this orbital. A covalent bond is when an orbital from this atom overlaps with an orbital from another atom. One way in which we could get orbitals to overlap is this head-to-head overlap. This particular orientation is called a sigma bond. Now, different orbitals on the same atom repulse each other. They don't like overlapping. So these two blue balloons, these would be one dumbbell-shaped orbital. But you can see that I have a green orbital and a purple orbital, and they are all pointing in different directions. In this particular example, they happen to be 90 degrees from each other. It can differ depending on what atom we're talking about. So imagine that you had two of these atoms, and you already had a sigma bond formed, a head-to-head overlap between two of the orbitals. and you want to form a second bond. Imagine getting these green orbitals to overlap. You are not going to be able to keep this sigma bond and still get green orbitals to overlap in this head-to-head configuration. An additional bond is going to have to be a lateral or side-to-side overlap. So if you wanted your green orbitals to overlap, maintaining this sigma bond, they would need to be this side-to-side overlap. This is called a pi bond. So, if two atoms have only one bond between them, it's a sigma bond. If they have a double bond, there's one sigma bond, one pi bond. If there's a triple bond, it's one sigma bond, two pi bonds. So in any bond, there is always one sigma bond, and additional bonds are pi bonds. Benzene has 6 carbon atoms in a ring and a total of 18 electrons involved in the bonding between these 6 carbon atoms. So what I have drawn so far is only showing the sigma bonds. In other words, the very first bond that's formed between any of these carbon atoms. Now each bond accounts for 2 electrons, and we have 6 bonds here. So this is only showing 12 of our 18 electrons. The orientation in which this is drawn, this is a planar molecule. Think of the bottom being tipped closer to you than the top. Now, we still have 6 more electrons that we have to figure out what to do with in this drawing. These are the same 6 electrons that were historically giving chemists so much trouble when they were trying to figure out structure of benzene. But the reason I have this tipped up a bit in the drawing is that we need to add our p orbitals. There's a p orbital perpendicular to the plane of the molecule for each of these 6 carbon atoms. In benzene, all 6 of these p orbitals can overlap each other. That means that these 6 pi electrons are not shared just between any 2 carbon atoms, but they are shared between all 6 carbon atoms. This is what is meant by delocalized electrons. So in Kekulé's dream, when he was talking about a snake biting its own tail and spinning, he was picturing these orbitals and electrons spinning around the entire ring. I told you that benzene is unusually stable, meaning that it doesn't react very easily. The reason it's so stable has to do with these overlapping p orbitals. This is also the reason it took us so long to figure out the structure of benzene. When we started our journey pre-1865, we were not aware that electrons could be shared by more than 2 atoms. Let's go back to Kekulé's dream. He described chains of carbon atoms that are twisting and turning like a snake. The head of one snake grabbed its own tail and formed a spinning ring. Think of these electrons in this p orbital cloud as a spinning snake ring. It is a continuous shared electron cloud. These delocalized electrons are free to go anywhere they need to go to prevent a reaction from happening. This is why it's so stable. Benzene is often drawn as a hexagon containing either a circle or dotted lines, but these are shortcuts. Nothing about that circle or those dotted lines tell us that they represent 6 electrons. These only convey the structure of benzene to someone who already knew it. If you need to convey the structure of benzene to someone else, you need to learn about resonance structures. Thanks for watching Chemistry in a Nutshell. If you feel that I've earned it, please like this video and subscribe to my channel.